We, like those who oppose the long night of communism, no longer have any mechanisms within the formal structures of power that will protect or advance our rights. We too have undergone a coup d'etat, carried out not by the stone-faced leaders of a monolithic communist party, but by the corporate state. We may feel, in the face of the ruthless corporate destruction of our nation, our culture, and our ecosystem, powerless and weak, but we are not. We have a power that terrifies our corporate masters. Any act of rebellion, no matter how few people show up or how heavily it is censored, chips away at corporate power. Any act of rebellion keeps alive the embers for larger movements that follow us. It passes on another narrative. It will, as the state consumes itself, attract wider and wider numbers. Perhaps this will not happen in our lifetimes, but if we persist, we will keep this possibility alive. If we do not, it will die. This sublime madness is the essential quality for a life of resistance. It is the knowledge that when you stand with the oppressed, you are treated like the oppressed. It is the acceptance that although empirically all that we struggle to achieve during our lifetime may be worse, our struggle validates itself. Hannah Arendt wrote in The Origins of Totalitarianism, the only morally reliable people are not those who say this is wrong or this should not be done, but those who say, I can't. They know that as Immanuel Kant wrote, if justice perishes, human life on earth has lost its meaning. And this means that like Socrates, we must come to a place where it is better to suffer wrong than to do wrong. We must at once see and act and give it what it means to see. This will require the surmounting of despair, not by reason, but by faith. Dr. Rio and Albert Camus' novel, The Plague, is not driven by ideology. He is driven by empathy, the duty to minister to suffering, to those who suffer, no matter the cost. Empathy, or what the Russian novelist Vasily Grossman called simple human kindness, becomes in all despotisms a subversive act. To act on this empathy, the empathy for families terrorized by our war machine in Iraq, Afghanistan, Yemen, and Somalia, the empathy for undocumented mothers and fathers being torn from their children on the streets of our cities, the empathy for Muslims who were demonized and banned from our shores, fleeing the wars we created, the empathy for poor people of color, gunned down by police in our streets and locked in cages, the empathy for girls and women trafficked into prostitution, the empathy for the earth that gives us life and is being contaminated and poisoned for profit. I have seen that it is not humankind that is impotent in the struggle against evil, but the power of evil that is impotent in the struggle against humankind. The powerlessness of kindness, of senseless kindness, is the secret of its immortality. It can never be conquered. The more stupid, the more senseless, the more helpless it may seem, the vaster it is. Evil is impotent before it. The prophets, religious leaders, reformers, social and political leaders are impotent before it. This dumb, blind love is humankind's meaning. Human history is not the battle of good struggling to overcome evil. It is a battle fought by a great evil struggling to crush a small kernel of human kindness. But if what is human in human beings has not been destroyed even now, then evil will never conquer. Thank you.